see more of a skirmishing complexity than a teamfight complexity.
Also because they run Oracle too. Complexity run Oracle a fair amount, which is a solution for the Batrider that a lot of the T1 teams turn to, or other T1 teams, I should say.
It's actually really a sad stat to come up with Complexity, but Oracle was their only hero they Escape won a game with during Star Series. That was the only time they won a game during Star Series. Everything else was a 2-0 to Secret, then they got 2-1 down in the lower bracket.
That was a bad week for them.
Yeah, that you sort of scratch that one, forget that one, we'll come back to it later. Remaining. We'll never come back to it at all.
Can be a firecracker. Five it's like, oh, remaining. We lost all these. We really got to get in shape before the wild card, and this is for all the marbles.
All right, so you got the Oracle up for Complexity. Now you're going to get our gel free card for the Slark.
Yes, so I think they need even more team fight now from Escape. Like right now they have two decent AoE team fight heroes, Batrider, not very reliable versus the Slark and the Oracle. So I think they might even need a third one. I think that's at least my opinion. So you can catch the Oracle out, or else you don't have a good way to
Escape Gaming's turn to pick.
Control the Oracle. So the Morphling pick coming out from Escape is a little strange, but with the SD ban already out and actually no silences from Complexity, who responded with an instant Beastmaster pick.
That's why your brain stopped for a second. You're like looking, it's like Morphling instantly Five into Beastmaster. Yeah. Complexity do like that. Like Swindles, I know he was talking about Reserve this at Epicenter, time. Where he really likes to just quick pick. So he always takes the opposition like a little bit off balance.
But you don't have enough time to counter.
Yes.
What if you wanted an offlaner with a silence?
I'm not saying it's a good idea.
Okay.
I'm just saying Swindles, that's what he does.
That's a good point, because it certainly confused me. It's like, wow, they're really bold about that Beastmaster. And yep. The general consensus nowadays is if you're on Dire, you need at least one good Roshan hero. And Beastmaster is what I would consider a good Roshan hero.
Complexity, so the AA kicks in. So there's no heal from Oracle. There's still the Get Out Jail free card in a way. Is there, but it won't last long enough to save him from an ice blast.
I think the AA. Well, we'll see AA for a lot of reasons. Remaining. One is team fight. That's probably actually like not the most popular. The second one is to deal with Alchemist and Huskar, and the third one is to deal with Mass Heal. Oh, I Alchemist and Huskar I put in their special category because they do heal, but they're just a kind of different beast where all strategies are centered around, whereas like Dazzle Oracle, it's heal, but that's not what the strategy is based around. So we see AA pick sometimes early to cover their own Huskar and or Alchemist pick.
Mm-hmm. I always want to like just throw this question out there just in case. With the Ancient Apparition, do you think about the aggro tri-lane again? Like, do you think of the power of Chilling
Escape
Touch?
Gaming's
it's too difficult
back.
Nowadays. I think Ancient Apparition and these ranged heroes that can't do anything when heroes jump on you, like Shaman, for example, like you can't channel your shackles when you're getting jumped. I think these heroes suffer greatly in the offensive lane, and Ancient Apparition is almost always better suited remaining. To the safe lane because you need your level 6 and you're not very useful before then.
Mm-hmm. 5 seconds
unless
remaining.
You have a good partner.
And that gives the freedom for ES to roam around. Love it. So the final ban out from Escape, the last one they think Complexity's going to go for.
So they banned out the Alchemist, because that's what I was talking about, the AA like covering one of your picks, because they Escape don't have last pick. So if they wanted a Huskar or an Alchemist, and they didn't want the other team to get AA, they'd have to ban it out in the 5th, 8th, which actually would not be that bad, but they probably for multiple reasons too. It's also very good versus the Morphling, I forgot about that. Can't Strength Morph.
So say goodbye to the Elder Titan.
Turn to pick.
Covered their Morphling a lot, though.
Yeah, they really have.
Really committed with the Shadow Demon, the Elder Titan, and the AA pick.
Kind of sad as well that Morphling doesn't have, like, one of those standard heroes he wants to steal. Like, there's no one who's overly tanky. Like,
it's
10 seconds.
So the Morphling is mainly going to be, like, a repositioner slash burst. But if he does get a hero out of position, he can burst him down quite quickly.
Mm-hmm.
And you got the Batrider and the Earth Spirit to help out with
Reserve
that. The question
time.
Is how does Cinder and Tide all together? What is this fifth hero that makes this Escape Gaming lineup a little bit more, I don't want to say survivable, but stable, I think is a better word here.
Doug's always pretty safe, I would say, but just
then
scaling.
How would you lane it? Would you throw that onto Koi'va?
Yeah, scaling for Koi'va is generally better. So the Koi'va are different things. Queen of Pain is not a flavor that we've really seen from Escape, and this is going to be quite the interesting matchup because of it.
You know, I was kind of hoping that this would happen. When I was looking over Escape, one of the biggest problems that they kind of had was Koi'va getting shut down early on and then just disappearing into the jungle for a very long time and then come back out again. I was having a small chat with Sebastian. He didn't reveal too much because he's trying to be a nice guy. But he was talking about just how Koi'va, like, if he does get that rotation out, like, everyone should be really, really careful of this, because then it's Escape playing as a full squad, not this 4-1 style, which they kind of fell into and lost a couple of games with.
It might be Era's Queen, though.
Oh, okay.
I think the Koi'va...
And then the Koi'va Morphling mid?
Yeah. Koi'va is the true one on this team. It's kind of like OG, I think, where Miracle might go mid, but he still is highest farm priority. And I think it's a very similar story for Escape. You'll almost always see him playing a scaling hero, Juggernaut, Invoker, these sort of heroes, Tinker, that just demand a lot of farm. And Morphling is that type of hero, especially in this lineup.
That exact question could be the reason why Complexity is taking their time with their last pickup. They're not 100% certain who's in the mid anymore. And I suppose Escape could also just change it around, like the Morph or the Quap. They can switch that around. Even the Batrider is capable of going into the mid.
But this opens up a very difficult lane for Complexity, because they have to deal with Earth, Spirit, and Queen of Pain. That is probably one of the most dominant solo laner plus support roamer that you'll see in today's Dota, I would say. Maybe rivaled by like Bounty Hunter plus like Death Prophet, or Riki plus Death Prophet. It's very similar in that it's your mid laner's worst nightmare.
Riki.
DK maybe okay.
Well, speaking of the Riki, he doesn't have a Death Prophet to combo with, but I'm called Beastmaster Call.
They had a silence, though. I think they definitely needed a silence versus Morphling and Queen, and Riki kind of covers both of those bases, as well as shoring up the mid lane. So it will be Koi'va on Queen of Pain. So that is not what I expected, but I think Koi'va is their best player, and I think that it's a very high-risk hero for any team to pick.
I'm okay with it for game number one as well. So we see both these teams. It is the first game of the morning, so they've got to warm up. They've got to get the movement around. And Escape have given themselves a wonderful, I'd say, like, muscle-flexing lineup.
First game usually means safe, though.
It does. But this seems to be more of a let's just kick off and start with the flow. You know, we'll do our rotations. We'll get our timings right. If this works for game number one, it's going to spell like a lot of confidence through the rest of the day. Do we want to do predictions as well?
Yes, let's do it.
Okay. Team with the first barracks
prepare
kill.
Prepare for battle.
Yeah, it's difficult with this because you don't really have a push lineup.
This one's pretty much who you think is going to win, because I think both teams have like only one hero who can really is really good at hitting buildings.
Uh-huh.
Well, Radiant is Morphling and Dire is Beastmaster.
I'm gonna switch over to the Escape side
of things
on that
Escape
one. Yeah, player plays the most observed wards by 15 minutes, Cinderin.
I'm going with Z-Freak.
You're going to Z-Freak?
He's Riki.
Total number of smoke gank kills at the end of the game. That's actually a really... With a Riki on the field and you got Moonlight Shadow from Complexity, that number's going to be pretty low.
I'm going 5-8.
Yeah, 5-8 looks pretty good. And the total number of towers killed before 25 would also be quite low. I think you're pretty safe with 0-5.
I think it's usually 6-10. I think it might be like a split push kind of game where they trade a lot of towers. So even if it's slow, they can take a lot of towers down.
Okay, well, let's talk about our lanes, because they're currently settling in at the moment. So it looks like we are going to be running the safe lane with the Ancient Apparition. A very early ward coming out from Complexity, so they're just, like, this feels very, very standard. Watch the top lane, make sure there's no, like, full-on stacking of the camps, no easy flash farming for the offlane Batrider.
The battle begins. The prize is mine!
I was wondering where the music went.
Can't have mood music the entire game. Alright, so Z-Freak on the hunt, always gonna be careful of that Riki. And we just stay on ball with the two for the courier movement.
Z-Freak, will he get the courier? We see, just parked up there.
Everyone's babysitting all the way through. Nice little deep ward early on from Escape, so they get rid of that complexity mid-ops. Gonna make life a little bit more dark for Limp. And, okay, yeah, Yabstor knows there's Z-Freaks in the neighborhood. He clears them out, knows he runs north, and then just will be the courier anyway. So they'll make sure that the tankos get to the mid. And then it's up to Quaife, but like, how aggressive do you want to be playing this mid lane? Like, you're up against a Mirana as a Queen of Pain, and you're a Queen of Pain that hasn't skilled anything. Like, there's no Shadow Strike out yet. Is he waiting for to see if the Earth Spirit's going to have a successful jump in?
His creep wave was not in a good position for him. You don't want to go when the Mirana's on her hill.
Ooh, Keizu, CPing out. Is he going to have enough time? Yep, he will. Problem with not having extra stuns coming in from the Ricky. And then Limp being initiated on as well. Yapsaw. He's beating into Limp, but Limp is able to leap himself away to safety.
But not able to get that second Shadow Strike. If you get that, if you get the second Shadow Strike, then you can maybe prevent Mirana from using herself. But she's going to be full HP and should probably start faring over regen soon.
I'd ask if you got a ticking time bomb right now on the bottom lane. The fact that you're giving Era free space on the bottom lane, but you also have a Beastmaster who's moved into the jungle. So Swindles is easily keeping up with any kind of farm. It's Iron Talon jungling at its greatest. So the Beastmaster's fine. It's something which he also with me down in Manila, where he's like, you know what, we just have like AFK farming for the first 10 minutes for a Beastmaster. He'll come in with the Blink Dagger as well as a level 1 Necro Book and then just go ham after that point. So Swindles enjoying his farm on the inside the jungle, Era enjoying his in the mid, on the bottom. While the middle lane, Yabzor again looking for a rotation in there, but Z-Freak, he's stalking. Just can't get any levels because he can't find, there's no junglers coming out from Escape.
More important for Z-Freak to keep track on Yapzor than the other way around because the middle matchup. Like, Queen of Pain has the upper edge on a Mirana, so that means the onus is on Complexity to make sure that the Queen of Pain doesn't get out of control. And Mirana needs a little bit of time. You need your axe, you need your items. Queen of Pain really doesn't need that many. Maybe a null or two before you can start going crazy.
It's just the mana pool you're looking for right on the quad.
A little bit of HP too, so you can blink aggressively if necessary or tower dive, because she's just that type of hero.
Level 1 Z-Freak will TP down to the bottom lane, so they don't want to drag Swindles out of the jungle yet. He has managed to get 4.5 levels in 3 minutes. He's now the highest CSer on the board, and Z-Freak soaked up almost 2 full levels from being on that bot lane. But there's no big tower pressure coming out with the Morphling. It's not like you got a lone druid over on this Escape lineup. And Yabzor continues to try and be a bit of a pest to Swindles. Rather difficult to do. He doesn't have a TP scroll, so there's no easy boulder out and just TP. But he's always got the distance with the rolling boulder.
He's trying to slow down Swindles a little bit, but Swindles is already almost level 5.
Yeah.
It's very early in, and he has a TP scroll just in case things go awry. Like if Earth Spirit starts up with a stun and Queen of Pain tries to blink over, he might still be able to get out in time.
It actually opens up to also Swindle's rotations, because if he hits that level 6, he can move around with Z-Freak. They actually have a good ganking lineup. They could bring a lot of pressure to that bottom lane. But so far, it's still just a little bit of harassment here and there. Try and catch up to on any kind of farm. They might be getting a little bit annoyed here, Escape, but overall, like, it's not that big of a difference. Like, you're only looking at 500 gold or experience swinging either way. And Keizu is now finally going to invade into the Complexity jungle, so they bring over the Batrider, and this will restrict the movement of Swindles a lot. Not to mention get some much-needed farm in for Keizu.
That would be a lot easier for them, though, if they had a Kill Rune on the Queen of Pain. And she got a 4-minute Bounty Rune on top, the Kill Rune going in the way of Mirana.
Ooh, Yabzor with the smoke screen. This could be the first blood right now. He wants to go for the kick. But it won't happen. First Limp, blood. An easy movement up, and he actually had the first blood rune, the double damage onto that Mirana.
They are very worried about the Beastmaster, and I don't know if Escape's actually going to have enough time to get the items that they want before this Beastmaster and Riki combo, as you mentioned, is going to wreak havoc around the map.
You're worried about the overcommitment? Like, just to stop him?
They need to get their farm up. They need, like, Blink on Batrider. They need, like, whatever first item is up on Morphling, level 6 on Ancient Apparition. I think these three things are the most important things for them. And if they don't come out very soon, we're going to Beast Sensor's first move with a Roar, with a Smoke and a Reeky Smoke Cloud, and people are dying around the map, and then you have that one piece of the puzzle that's always missing. I think that complexity can take down all objectives and kind of sweep them down after that, because you have some supports that are just very weak to the Reeky, and even some cores on it too.
Well, we need to get the farm up. Currently, there's no real stacks for them to work with. Like, Yapzor's only managed to get one double stack inside the jungle. So, Keizu doesn't have an easy flash farm. Maybe he was hoping he could catch up like a big Swindle stack, but Swindle's not even a single point up in the Wild Axe. He's not looking to clear that way. It's all about Call of the Wild. It's all about Iron Talon just relying on his own strength. So there's nothing for Escape to steal. And the Moonlight Shadow being triggered, they're actually drawing a line to head to the top lane. Now, there's an Observer Ward that Limp did that right underneath. So, yeah, there's no surprises here, and Keizu hides in the trees.
Now, Swindles has parked himself right into that camp. Let's see if Keizu gets an eye on this Hog. They could use a scan. Actually, they don't have a scan available. It looks like they used it a couple of minutes ago, but this is about the time where you're worried.
Well, they see each other now. Z-Freak as well as Limp were trying to make a bit of a move through the south, but yep, there's Yapzor rolling balls himself forward. Swindles slowed down, silence dump, the Firefly forward. They're going to get right on top of him, and Swindles, he will burn.
That is a very, very bad kill to give up because he is the highest level in the game right now. Swindles is level 7 right now, and they were trying to go for the typical smoke, get a tower kill after killing a hero with Roar. That is a very common thing, especially when you have a Beastmaster, because you take down towers very quickly. But his team backed off. They probably got wind of this because all their heroes just suddenly disappeared on the map, and someone was like, okay, well, I'm right here next to a camp, I'm gonna farm it. And they just lost a very high priority hero without the Reeky there, the scout, without their safe laner there to really protect him from that sort of maneuver.
I want to watch this swing just continue as we still haven't felt like the big presence yet. Like, we talk about the fact that Slark as well as Morphling are both out of play at the moment. Who's really going to come online first? Like, do you want to see Chessie with early Shadowblade rotating around trying to find these support kills?
It has to be the Slark, because Slark does not match up well versus the Morphling in the later game. Morphling's a lot more slippery than even the little fish, and he also is just a lot more safe when he hits towers. He also just does a lot more damage if left unchecked because of the agility morph. So I think that the Morphling just poses a lot more threats. And like Slark, he can kill heroes, but he can't like instant kill heroes like a shotgun Morphling.
He has more of that sustained kind of damage. Once you pick up the Essence Shift, then life's gonna get a lot easier for you.
And the Scape are covering their bases. We see the scouting out of the Roshan pit with Ancient Apparition. So they do not want to give Complexity any quarter. They do have the Beastmaster, and they are respecting it.
And they know it's a hero that Swindles played a hell of a lot of, so it does make it a little bit easier. You got more data to work with to understand how Swindles will play this hero.
They don't have enough right-click damage for Roche just yet. Slark hasn't committed to any items. Maybe with Echo Saber it might be easier.
Yep. And they're counting the Necro Books, right?
And well, he died, so it's going to come up very slowly.
Yeah.
Normally, I think free farming Beastmaster Radiant's just straight jungle is like 14, 15 minute Necro 3. And he does not have his Necro 1 yet.
Rider is rapidly approaching that
might get a
dagger.
Courier kill.
What's on it? Not really a hell of a lot. And because the movement speed, the courier was up.
He'll look for it on the way back.
Well, Sendarin gets his Strangles, but it will cost a Courier. Nope, Z-Freak waits again.
Radiance top
tower. Doesn't want to attack. He's looking for a hero kill. A Courier's not enough. Ice Blast is flying all the way up to the top lane. This looks more like a way to dissuade Huntsman as well as Chessie from attacking into the Tier 1 tower. Does his job.
And Keizu will have his Blink very soon after farming up this creep wave. Should just be about 3 to 4 more creeps. Z-Freak trying to look for a weak spot in the escape defense, but
well, with the sentry
really
ward down, it's difficult. Like, he just got flagged.
Yeah, I'm actually a little surprised he didn't go for the Kuriko. It looks like he...
Oh, Coin Bar blinks, Darth gets the extra flow into Z-Freak. Smoke screens up for the kick and waveform and the strike. Oh, they made sure that Z-Freak definitely went down.
Denied.
I think now the pressure has switched to Complexity. Complexity are like, they haven't used Roar yet. They haven't been able to really move around the map too much with the Riki. Riki's not level 6. They're really struggling in the level department. Oracle is also not a level 6, whereas you have the weaker support in the Ancient Apparition already throwing out Ice Blast a minute before.
Yep. I think you're right, man. This is when complexity need to be able to control the pace of the game, and only none of the items to do it just yet. Keizu is finishing up his Blink Dagger, while Koifa and Yapsaw are going to smoke maneuver up through the river, and they're headed up north. They're pinging perfectly onto Chessy as well as Hanskin. And Chessy, he is low, and the Ice Blast man, he can kill Chessy anyway. He pounds it, barely gets out of range. Hanskin will have to sacrifice himself. He goes for the False Promise, the TP out, cancelled by Yapsaw, and Hanskin, he should just pop, and there she got close. Another hero kill going the way of escape, and with three heroes up on the top lane, they may push the issue into the tier 1 tower.
It seems like Complexity are the ones that are waiting for some sort of item, waiting for some sort of timing that they want to move around, but I think Beastmaster Roar plus Arrow, Beastmaster Roar plus Oracle, like any of these two combinations, or Beastmaster plus anyone on their team can get a kill. And
but Beastmaster hasn't been involved in anything. Like, he comes down the bottom lane and spends most of his time hitting a replicant.
Yeah. At least his build's good at doing that. Right?
That is... Yes. That's glass is most definitely half full of milk. I'm actually wondering how Swindles goes now. Like, because he's walking around with a belt of giant strength. The level 1 Necro Book is sitting on the courier. Okay, so he... Yeah, that's actually just what he bought. Because he could have gone for the Blink Dagger if he thought he could wait a little bit longer, but they get the level 1 Necro Book, so there's no jump at initiation. He's got to move with the rest of his team.
If they wait too long, though, like the Morphling's going to have Lincolns, and then Batrider's going to have his Force Staff, so they have to strike very, very soon. But at the same time, Escape kind of anticipated. They're already moving into there. Batrider is not smoked up, so they did walk into the Observer Ward, and now the jig is up. But still, Beastmaster has yet to prime Roar.
Complexity realize also that movement, so instead they rotate next to heroes. Ifrit TP'd himself up to the T1 tower on the top lane. Chessy is still walking around with 2.4k gold, and they haven't added any pressure really to this T1 tower. They're sitting at 531 for a lane, which has been pretty... Okay, mid lane, just into him. Lasso, Sonic Wave, and Ice Blast. The Lasso holds him perfectly in position. And now it's 4-1, but they realize Hanskin was going to be in the neighborhood, especially when Erika jumps to the Replicant, and Hanskin will go down too. The Adaptive Strike is thrown back over his shoulder to get the kill on Oracle. Now it's going to be the second T1 tower claimed by Escape.
Escape looking very solid in this early game, taking down more towers than Complexity, getting more kills, and invading Complexity's jungle a lot more. And the items are coming in. Morphling's just a few hundred gold away from that Lincoln Sphere, and Complexity will have to rely on the split push.
Yeah, they're trying to get the trade off top lane. Chessy trying to pounce to keep Keizu away from here. He'll have to go inside that Shadow Dance to escape to the tree line. Keizu holds off the fight on the top tier 1, but on the bottom lane, Yapsaw, roared up by Swindles, put inside the smoke screen. Yapsaw needs to get out of range, and he just can't do it. The Ice Beast coming in, which Z-Freak as well as Swindles will oblige Cinderin by staying inside of it. But there's no follow-up at this point. With no Sonic Wave, they're not really that scared of the burst damage from Koifa at the moment.
Up tower, Slyke. Slyke do not want this tower to get denied, but they have no choice.
TP zone out from Keizu. So Era will get the denial. They also have an Observer Ward, which is watching nicer and deeply into the Complexity jungle. They obviously won't see Chessy moving around now. Not with that Shadow Blade, gonna pounce on the Keizu. That's a lot of damage. And with the arrow flying into just off target, Keizu able to blink himself back down to the river and away to safety. Arrow that really needed to hit from Limp. Try and just stall up this escape momentum.
Nice move by Keizu. That's the common Batrider play when you're dealing with a Slark. Wait until the last second and then try and push him back with the flame break until you can blink out. And he had some nice movements there also to dodge that arrow. But as you mentioned, that's a very important kill. The Slark Shadowblade reveal, now you'll probably see a lot more detection on them. We see a couple of sentries and a dozen of the Ancient Apparition, and they're definitely thinking about getting a gem very soon. But they should be.
As long as they can hold on to it. Swindles is now 100 gold away from the Blink Dagger. So initiation from Complexity as they force into the bottom tier 2 tower. Get some good damage out. The other towers of Complexity aren't really being that heavily attack, so Escape can't get a good trade-off from this.
Yeah, but because the Batrider TP top, they know that they don't have to worry about any sort of initiation until some time to come. They have to hook it to the bottom.
Well, the Batrider's already here. Kataro smoke. The ice bar's gonna fly out, but Cinderu's in trouble. Chesney attacking the arrow from Rana, able to connect. And now Chesney low on life. Here jumps forward, but again, the saving grace from the Oracle is able to arrive. Chesney gets the big burst heal. This fight just splits up a little bit. Nape palming up, Keizu jumps in, gets the Lazu over on him here on the back lines, ward up, Keizu dropping down very low, he will go down, but the trade-off is also going to be with Hira. Yapzor's on the run, but it's Complexity, they are the ones finding the kills, the Sonic Wave bursting through from Koifa, but nothing will stop Chesney from claiming his double kill. Turn on the Magnetize, but they'll all survive, and Escape have finally given Complexity what they were looking for. A great team fight, one by one they march to their death.
So many misspells from Escape right there. First we had the rolling boulder into the pool that just completely whiffed the Shadow Dance Slark. And then we had the Batrider coming out from the lasso. He didn't have any Firefly, and although he got a high priority target in the Marana, there was no damage to follow up. They had the AA Blast come out, but the Queen of Pain was not there to follow up with her ultimate and her scream, and just a lot of things that were strange about that fight for Escape. They clearly wanted to defend, and honestly, I think it was all set up because they wanted to defend that top tower way too much. That top tower is generally regarded as the least important tower in the game. It doesn't really protect that much. You talked about it earlier, you're protecting your secret shop, maybe your ancients a little bit, but not really. I think the mid T1's a lot more important for that, but they chose to commit the Batrider TP to that, and because of that, Complexity, that was a green light for them to go hard on that T2 and bottom. Because of that fight one, those two towers down, now Roshan opens up for Complexity that was struggling in the early game. It was 5-1, Complexity with 5 unanswered kills.
Now, scene double. Complexity also have, they had such great vision until that ward finally got taken out. And Escape realized that after the fight happened, that's why they threw down 2 sentries to get rid of it. But then Complexity just throw in another ward. A little bit more shallower inside the Escape jungle, but it's in that perfect position. You said, Roshan is the next thing on Complexity's mind. We get to have a quick look at that fight again, too, as it really was just, you split up and you have both your Batrider and your Morphling isolated on either side of the fight.
Queen of Pain just had to come in a little bit too late. These heroes were so low. Imagine if they had combined that with any other spells, even something as simple as a Morphling Waveform.
Seemed to be really easy too for Hanskin. He was never really in any kind of peril. We might see peril now as the Smoke and Moonlight Shadow. Cinder is going to be the first one. Ice that if they can get rid of him nice and quick, you remove the Ice Blast from the field, so Hanskin can do whatever the hell he wants down the bottom lane. Keizu, he gets to the tree line, can't blink out just yet. He's got the urn as well as the orb on him, and now he'll just TP out. But this means the Complexity. No Ice Blast, no Batrider anywhere near the pit. It's a quick Roshan, but also Ricky Zeefrey getting caught out of position. So Complexity, they're going to have second thoughts about going for Roshan. The Necropooks were triggered. And yep, they're bailing out. But it's not as though Escape really have a great lineup for taking Roshan from underneath them either. And they have Radiant's to retreat. Keizu's already moving up to the top lane, which has been pressured.
Do have a great lineup to protect Rosh. Not do it though, as you mentioned. So that's one of the downsides of their lineup. Need to wait for Morphling to get a lot bigger. He does actually have the Dragonlance build, a rather unusual one that we see from Morphling. Generally, when you're hitting towers, you're uncontested as Morph. I think the Dragonlance is very good for those heroes that are in the front of the team fight hitting towers, but I don't think that's what Escape's lineup is based around. But overall, good stats. Morphling needs strength, Morphling needs agility.
Maybe it's an answer to the fact that Escape don't really have a great high ground pusher anyway. What do you get with the Batrider and the Queen of Pain? They're not going to be the ones to attack up.
Yeah.
So they need something for that.
Might be useful later to kite the Slark and or the Marana if he decides to go for a Hurricane Bike, but it's just cost efficient. They're struggling a little bit. Maybe he was thinking about going a BKB, but realizing Death's that is bounty. Not quite the right time for it. And Escape having a very concentrated effort to keep in that mid area of the map. This mid T1 tower on the Radiant side is the most important tower in the game for both sides right now. They Complexity need to take that down, and Escape need to protect that.
At least Escape have extra items to help them do so with Complexity. They're going to four-man smoke that extra TP down the bottom lane. They are looking for an opening.
Dire's middle tower
is under attack. But is the opening just for Roshan, or is it going for kills? They only got one observer ward, and it doesn't see anybody. Actually, they do have a second one. There's one up near the Radiant Secret Shop.
Thinrin is in a little bit of a weird position. Earth Spirit, let's see.
Oh, the replicate. Limp just arrowed it. He doesn't actually break his smoke with it, but it reveals the fact they are smoked up, and now they engage over on the replicate. Now realize this, so
they're still instilling a lot of fear into escape. Combine the smoke with the Moonlight Shadow, and you always have to fear
Kazu coming over. They're gonna trigger a second dust, but Chessy, the tier 1 tower is already gone, so he just blew two dust there from escape. Didn't find any openings whatsoever. In fact, Complexity, they're already getting out. EP straight back, now the blink is up for Swindles, and they're circling over towards Roshan. A circle's actually coming out from Yapsor, just saying, yo guys, like, they just took out tier 1 tower. Roshan is most definitely on the cards.
Look at Roshan. He's perched a little bit away from his usual position in the pit. Usually he's like deeply recessed in there, maybe.
He's admiring his skull collection.
Finding a new spot.
Swindles actually TP'd himself up to the top lane. This got scattered out by escape, so they're just pinging the fact that the Beastmaster is not anywhere near Roshan.
But he is forcing someone to go back, which is normally very effective, but when you're versus a Morphling who can send a replicate TP to split push out the lane and then come back to the fight with a replicate, it's not as effective, but
Complexity just smoked on top of an Alps ward. They should have known as well. In fact, yeah, Sindarin, he was walking around there with a sentry ward already on him before they did the smoke. Now he throws it down, realize both the Alps and sentry is there, but it's Complexity who are not here to defend Roshan. Escape, they're looking to bring him down, and at this point they might be able to succeed. The scans used by the Radiant side, it should now start to ping and flag red as Complexity. Here they come, Roshan low, he's at 1k life, they've almost finished the job. Here comes Complexity, arrow will fly forward, it hits Koifa. He does have the Aegis Evolve, however, Hira trying to get Swindles out. They use only that for trying and force the Thunder Hold, and Koifa lets the ulti blow. He triggers the Aegis to the Immortal. Necros are around him, Chessy will get in, and then the Blink, they get back up, but it is far enough. No, not with Kazu being bored. They get the attack to strike, so you will lose the slot. That's allowing Hira to block the path with the Morphling, but Hanskin giving them a life, just keep on fighting. Hira on the run, another kick, catching out two. Hira needs more time. The Linkers is finally back off cooldown. He'll waveform up. Can he survive? He holds in the tree lens. There's not enough mana for him to TP out. They don't realize he's in the trees. He'll start the TP. Swindles, now the axes will fly, but it's all a little too late. The extra TP out as well, coming from Koifa. They will get out of the pit. It cost him a little bit, but it was a 3-for-1 trade-off in total, but that's including the Aegis of the Immortal.
That should have been so much worse for Escape. I don't even think that Bray's getting away with murder really quite does it there.
Getting away with easy deaths.
There were a lot of small things, though, for that fight that set it up. Koikva, I think, constantly using Orchid on the Roshan, because that was a fight of like a matter of seconds. If Complexity have gotten there, I would say even like 3/4 of a second earlier, they likely could have killed Queen of Pain, killed Roach, and taken the Aegis, but they were just waiting for a couple of things. The TP mid, so they could smoke, came out a little bit late. Hanskin, I believe, was waiting for an Observer Ward coming from the Chicken.
Kazu, they're prepping! There's your leap, and well, Kazu can't survive. No, yeah, he can't survive. The kick from Yapsol wasn't going to control up enough. And then, well, Z-Freak, he's coming back in. Do you actually think that was a real Cinder? Either way, it was a replicate. They're going to boulder, four staff out. As he's still on the hunt under the cover of the Moonlight Shadow, Syndrin, he's a little bit out of position here. Swindles going to start with a war Necrobox, and Syndrin, he will evaporate his ice. Complexity finding some free kills across the map, and this will let them push with the Necrobox triggered. That tier 2 tower stays numbered.
Tower is not very low.
Escape do not seem that well versed in playing around the AA. We've seen a lot of hero staples coming out for Syndrin, the Dazzle, the Mental Spirit, the Winter Wyvern, but with the Ancient Apparition, you can't buy time for your team to come. Winter Wyvern and Dazzle both buy maybe a good 5 or 6 seconds, but Ancient Apparition, if you get cut out of position, you're just dead. There's nothing your team can do about it.
kind of surprising when Syndrome walked outside of his base, but is this also then just down to vision? The fact that Escape can't keep any kind of vision over the ruined jungle complexity, that's where their attack angles have come every single time. They've taken a really good fight. They've had Obs up on the hillsides, and Escape, they're always countering it a little bit too late. This is getting a little bit easier now because Keizu's got his gem. And this means also you don't have the moving Obs ward of Z-Freak.
They've needed this a long time ago though because of the Slark with a Shadow Blade too. Like, you're countering two heroes with one item, which would be a good proposition in my book if they had not conceded that big fight around the Radiant Jungle.
Maybe they're just worried about losing it too early on, like they didn't feel confident in the team fights after what happened on bot lane.
Yep. But now we see Morphling starting to build a little bit more damage, Ghost Scepter and EB, so he can actually kill people now. The Hurricane Pike, I think, is a nice adaptation when you're up against the Riki in particular, because Lingus is not going to save you from the smoke cloud. So I think we see, like, Sand Kings, I think, they also go for Force Staff before Blink Dagger when you're up against a Riki, and I think this is kind of the same mentality coming out from Era. So I like this touch. However, I don't know if it's going to be enough for them. It is a lot of unnecessary stat in the HP region and the intel. So maybe they might lack damage because of this.
Complexity 5-man smoke. Escape were actually looking for a kill on the bot lane. They scanned inside the tree line to the south of the bot lane, thinking that maybe someone was hovering around there. It's not the case. Chessy moving forward. Era, he's so close. Chessy's going to just rotate around him. And he needs more help. The Moonlight Shadow is going to last for just a little bit longer, but it's Syndra who gets caught out once again. Swindle's fighting him on the bottom lane. Era will make it back to his own tier 3 tower. But now Swindle's revealed. The rest of Escape, do they want to fight this? No, no, they are getting the hell out of Dodge.
The one in the saddest AAs you'll see, the Tranquil Boots stick light.
Well, if you got that card for Syndrome with a plus death, 0 for 5 already.
Points. Oh, I put Yapzor in.
Points are looking good, huh?
Put Yapzor. Syndrome dies a lot, which is just typical of their playstyle. They sacrifice him up so that his teammates can get items. However, it's not have any items.
It's actually kind of funny. In all the games that Escape have played in the last month, they actually haven't had, like, Syndrome used to always be like that. Like, he was the Bane picker, right? Like, you'd have, like, these guaranteed stuns, these guaranteed combos. But he actually hasn't played, like, a solid stun hero for Escape in about a month. Like, it's always something like Keeper of the Light or such. Like, it's more of that supporting kind of style.
I like the defensive supports, actually, for him a little bit more. I think it's what they need because it seems like, Koikva in particular is a little bit leashed in when he's playing the Queen. I think, like, when you have a defensive support, that's kind of like your ticket to just go crazy. Remember Sinnoh and Havost? When Sinnoh played Winter Wyvern and Havost was on, like, Weaver?
Yeah.
It just, they complement each other a lot. And when you have an aggressive hero and you're just farming with it the whole time, you're wasting a lot of aspects of a hero. Imagine if he were on Invoker, it was for spin, but imagine if he had played Invoker like this. His net worth would be a lot more. His net worth would be probably 16,000 at this point, and he'd be able to take down a lot more towers and do a lot more damage because the peak of Invoker is, like, 25 minutes plus, like Radiant's now is when Invoker is starting to shine, whereas I think this is where Queen of Pain starts to fall off when you haven't gotten killed with the Orchid and your teammates are falling like flies in a lot of these fights.
Don't fall for it, Swindle. Don't fall for it. There was a replicant moving straight past the mid lane. It was a Batrider who was just like wandering himself back. This is not a bad trade-off for Escape. They took out the tier 2 tower up on the top lane. A little bit of chip damage being done to the tier 3. Like, same has happened on bottom lane, but that's just complexity. We're just pushing a wave. So Escape can at least fight on their terms. They do have the top 2 net worth on the field, the Morphling as well as the Queen of Pain. The E-Blade is also rapidly approaching for the Morphling, but already a bit of an answer for Chessy coming for that. So he already had the Echo Saber and the Shadow Blade. Now he's going to add the BKB to his item list.
Yes, and they have even more things to deal with it. I think the Handskin Fate's Edict will nullify almost all of the shotgun damage if he is quick about it. And more importantly, the Aegis of the Immortal is looking to go complexity's way with most of the Observer Wards being taken down.
Are they going to Moonlight Shadow themselves over the river? There's no Obs or Sentries looking for this. There wasn't Obs in the mid lane. They're going to come pretty close to a replicate of Yapzor, but they know it's not the real one. Chessy again is Cindering the dying to start this fight. He's right in the middle. They should jump more. They turn for the Ice Blast. The BKB goes for Chessy. And yep, he wants Cindering in the grave. 0-6 now for Cindering as Chessy wants to keep the doubt numbers going their way. Chessu. Okay, that's it. They're out. They're out. He's got his blink up. He's still got his blinker sphere as well. They've all got TP scrolls. So again, Cindering doing what kind of has to for his team. Takes it.
But if there was any question before about whether or not Complexity had control of Roshan in the surrounding area, there is no doubt now.
They might be a little bit sad that Limp had to trigger his DD rune already. Because Roshan is up in about 25 seconds, so Complexity have a nice quick spawn for Roshan. I'm also wondering if that's still Coifer's null talisman. Yeah, it is. Z-Freak just, that's been sitting there since the last Roshan. So Z-Freak is just going to hold on to it.
Maybe you can drop it in taunt.
just drop it in front of him, just like stares him down, denies.
Asserting dominance is what.
Oh, he hides it. Wait, no, that's not hot. He just threw it over the tree line. On the other side of the tree line.
That is the one that you're not going to find.
I don't think anyone from the escape is really thinking walking around that place. Alright, so Complexity, Ice Blast, really good time from Cindering. He's going to scout this out. Also going to connect on three heroes of Complexity. It's not going to stop them from taking Roshan, however. It'll just make them a little bit more cautious. Hero's having his fun up on the top lane, continuously pushing that one out. He does have a replicate, and in fact, Escape, they're in a position where they can try and contest this, and there's already the jump from Chessy. Going on Koifa, he'll blink away Keizu. Now with the last two, they're bringing Chessy in deeper. They do have the vision of the Sentry Ward going down, as well as the gem. They can see Chessy until he goes to the shadow. It's the Sonic Wave! It hits huge! It hits three! They turn the Magnetize at 12, and Cinderin! Well, he's old reliable. Down again, 3-1 is the trade-off. All up from Yapzor, but he's playing catch with his dad. He hits the arrow limp perfectly on Yapzor. Say goodbye to him. The only upside from this is the fact that Keizu was able to survive and he holds onto the gem for Escape. The downside is Escape practically lost everything, including Roshan now.
It's hard to put an upside to that, to that fight. I think one of the things too is Kezu in the offlane, from the Batrider, you'll see a lot of Batriders change their build a lot when there are multiple Slark counters, or multiple Batrider counters. One of them being the Slark, Slay being the Oracle. I think he can beat faster than like Kezu at countering him, and I think even more importantly is the Riki, because Riki, like, he's always playing at a disadvantage to the Batriders. So you'll see a lot of the Batriders, they build a lot more tanky, they build more movement speed, they don't rely on the Lasso initiation with, like, you know, even like a Drums Force build, which is very good versus Smoke Cloud, which is very good for getting Firefly damage in these fights. I think if we have a recap at the end of the game of damage done, Kezu will be like one of the lowest, maybe even lower than Cinderin, I would say, in these fights, just because, like, he hasn't really been able to put out anything in these fights. Mm-hmm.
But is that when you start asking like your next item builds? Like, I'm looking at Koifa sitting on 3k gold. Does he get an aggressive item, or does he need to get like a Scythe of Ice? Does he need more control? Because you've got Lincolns across the boards to try and like counter Swindle's initiation. But do you have to go another defensive item and then just wait it out and try and make this game go like 55-60 and then look for a win condition?
S4's build of Orchid, BKB, AC. I think that build is just very, very consistent and continues to scale well into later games. So I think that would be my choice. Looks like he is going for Ultimate Orb, so Scythe of Ice maybe to deal with the Slark. So he can't pop his BKB. He could also be going with...
We get to have a look at his fight again, just nice and quickly.
So they expend the lasso on the BKB Chessy, but they don't have any physical damage to follow it up. Era thinks he's very safe because he's morphling. He goes in there, and he just gets blown up, just roared on the spot.
Well, we come back live now as Complexity, they're on the hunt. Yapzor in the tree line, they're able to hit the stun. And that means you'll say goodbye to the Earth Spirit. There was a small little tussle before with him, and that's why he was forced so far
Radiant's
north. And Era, very, very slippery. Morphling, always known as that one hero that's got three different escape mechanisms. So very, very difficult to kill. But he jumps himself down the bottom lane. He'll have to TP to the top in a moment, because the push is already coming. Keizu puts down the Firefly, trying to slow down Radiant's the advance of Complexity. Koifa doesn't even want to bar over. He's pushing the mid lane. He needs more money. And Complexity are pretty, well, they're not terrible, they're just not terrific at going through buildings.
quickly.
Yeah, the Aegis, you have a lot more wiggle room.
Oh, Chessy, be careful. Ice Blast is going to connect on him. That's a level 2 Ice Blast as well. They won't get any more damage thanks to the help of Hanskin. Fortunately, Hanskin also can't heal him up anymore until... Okay, yeah, now Ice Blast wears off and he's good. The Aura still takes the tier 2 tower bottom lane. They're getting much needed money to get these big items in for escape. And they haven't lost Rax yet.
They lost a T3, however, so I don't think Morphling will be able to trade.
But with the creep wave, Complexity will still come back. They're still, they're the ones in the lead, right? They're not under any kind of pressure to lose anything major. You open up the top Rax, try and let it go. Why force the issue now?
Creep. A lot of that also has to do with the Ancient Apparition. Like, Ancient Apparition doesn't really have any setup because lots are super unreliable. Like, Boulder is
Era,
ideal
top lane setup. Chessy to initiate. Era, Lincoln Sphere has already been triggered. Hurricane Pike, he can't get himself away. Now the Ice Block is on its way in. It'll connect on Chessy. The arrow is flying in too. Era doesn't catch it. The rest of Complexity just backing out. Era feeling very safe to go that lane thanks to his Replicant.
Yeah, he is very good defensive toolkit versus Riki plus one. So I think he just needs to keep on pushing, try and wear out his Aegis, but with a minute and a half left, Complexity
swindles, blink roll forward, this is going to be the gem lost for escape. Detection is gone, then again, no one is here who has an inventory slot to hold on to it.
And there's a refresher up on the Beastmaster.
Yep.
Swindles has the farm.
He's ready to go again, hasn't triggered it just yet, but now the blink forward. Everyone's so low! They get the Sonic Wave off the limp, he's protected! Three heroes down for escape! Complexity can just keep pushing. Hanskin, the perfect saving timing, so Complexity can just keep going. No big oldies up, but there's the blink refresher all. Era gonna hit by the arrow too, they bring him down! Chessy is, however, still very, very low. The tower damage was actually killing him off. He has the Aegis the Immortal, so he knows he's gonna be okay. Z-Freak, however, okay, no, he's actually fine. Hanskin got rid of the Orchid effect, so Z-Freak was not gonna pop from it. It was a nice play from Koifa, but better from Hanskin, who has just been every time there for his team.
Game really have nothing left at this point. Kogwa will take a spill, and that's one buyback coming out for them.
This Ice Blast has to be huge. It's going to hit over on three heroes as Swindles very deep, hunting the tier 4 towers. Wants TP out, won't be able to happen. And now they blink forward, finding Chessy. Complexity. There's some freebies coming the way right now of escape. They still took the mid rags, going for cop an arrow in the face. Z-Freak jumped in, go screen up, and they both get kicked. The Sentry Wards are down, so they can see Z-Freak. He has to go into his ultimate, try and protect himself for the moment, as this fight splits into multiple parts. Z-Freak has to go south, where Yapzal's hunting him, but as Chessy is dropping down low, the Orchid will help pop him. The gem recovered from escape, and Complexity, they have just given a lifeline here to escape. A get out jail free card.
Ow. Wendell's getting pulled to the T4, losing two gems, and all they got was a melee Rex out of that.
Oh, actually lost both of them.
Yeah.
That makes up for the double buybacks that escape had to expend.
Ow.
Game just got closer again.
Yeah, I thought that they were like pretty comfortable with their lead, and they had shown a lot of restraint by not committing to that top Rex earlier and waiting for a pickoff. And they got a nice arrow on Cinderin to start off that fight, and then things just went crazy.
They have to find a way to stop that bleeding. Don't push too far in. There's Complexity now. They're gonna lose their tier 2 tower mid. Era's on his way, he's looking good. Even with the buyback, he's still the top net worth on the field.
Dire's middle tower.
They need to find... I don't even think they need to find better control. Like, Complexity still seem to have everything they need to win.
They need to kill Oracle. Escape need to kill Oracle at the start of the fight. Like, they almost killed the Mirana, like, at the start of the fight. She was maybe 2-3% HP before she got the false promise on her from Oracle. If they kill Limp at the start of the fight, I don't think they get the Rex, or if they do...
How do you reach Limp, though? Like, the Batrider is kind of like the only one, or you
Morphling.
Have, like, Morphling Replicant? Like, do you actually use your Replicant aggressive to get what? Behind the lines?
You
just wave.
You use a shotgun. He doesn't have that much HP on the Oracle, just 1,000 HP. Queen of Pain, excellent at killing these heroes, but they have the Scythe of Vice now, so maybe they can catch a Slark, but Oracle's there with a False Promise. You are not killing the Slark. He'll just pop BKB, Shadow Dance, boom.
Four-man smoke maneuver right now from Complexity. They are heading down through the mid lane. They smoked well away from Escape's wards. And they, they're coming into the Radiant Jungle, and who are they going to find? Keizu is the closest one. Moonlight Shadow is going to trigger as well, because Keizu doesn't care about that. He's got the gem, and they jump forward. They find Quark, the Ice Blast connect over on three. They need a little bit more damage. You know, the last two! Keizu, we got a neutral! Hira! Oh boy! Yuma down as well! They can't get the Mortling out. They're all going Keizu to stay exactly where you are, and think about what you did! Complexity! They take three. The supports are the only ones left alive. I think Yapzor's going to try and make a little bit more space. He's going to go out and play here on Swiddles on the mid lane, turning on the silence. He needs to find this kill to try and slow down anything. Is Swindle's actually going to go down to Magnetize? Ticking, ticking, and boom! He'll drop down. Yapzor gets some level of freedom. The Necro Books may claim his life in return, especially when he kills him. He'll take the money, but he'll die for the cause. It may have been just long enough for Complexity not to take a full GG here. So they're going to do some heavy damage to Escape Space. Radiant's middle barracks are under attack.
The smoke cloud has just been so difficult for Escape to deal with. They built multiple force staffs, but if you pounce, you can't force step out of it, and that's exactly what happened to Quake with that fight, and you also want to build BKBs to deal with it, but then you have damage output. So like, all these combination of factors just led to Escape's like net worth not even really seeming close to what Plexi's net worth was, despite it not really being that out of hand for most of the game, man. Rather underwhelming performance from this game. He was up against a very difficult Batrider lineup, but I still think like there's always something to do with Batrider.
So yeah, trying to have a play here. Syndra doesn't have an ultimate, so Keizu just BKBs and Lancers. He's buying time. In 2 seconds, they come back up, and they BKB Kenzi, Hunsken. It's going to be the sacrificial lamb for Complexity, but you don't really care. Hunsken will drop that you managed to get Megas.
I think that was the only time he's lassoed the Oracle.
And GG, Escape will call it. They say there is no more joy to be had here. Complexity, they definitely didn't do it smoothly though. Complexity had like that one push that went down the mid. It's got a couple of question marks to be had. Like, do they overstay their welcome? Is this just first game jitters as well coming out from Complexity?
I think the levels, like level 7 Beastmaster kill was more important and really slowed them down a lot, but I think overall very solid play from Complexity. They had a game plan, and I think Escape